Also, may have climbed Mount Everest. Very few can do it. Similarly, we are all on that line. Actual experience comes to a few. Everybody will get it, but after a lot of struggle. Bahunam janmanam ante. So subtle is this truth. So Brahmaivedam Vishwam, Idam Vishwam. The word Idam, demonstrative pronoun, especially if it deals with the entire manifested universe. That's the meaning of the word Idam. The entire manifested universe, the subject matter of all physical science. Idam, pointing out a finger to the external reality. What is it? Vedanta, everything is Brahman. Brahmaivedam Vishwamityeva Vani. That is the utterance of the Shruti. Which Shruti? Mundaka Upanishad. From it also, we have taken our Republic's motto. Satyameva Jayate. Nanratam. Truth alone triumphs, not untruth. Then, Shruti Prute. So, Shruti says like this. Everything in the world is Brahman. Sarva is a Atharvanishtha Varishtha. The Atharva Upanishad. That's called Mundaka Upanishad, belonging to Atharva Veda. Tasmat, therefore, Edat Brahma Matram Hi Vishwam. This whole universe is nothing but Brahman. Brahma Matram is only Brahman. Just like pot is only clay. We have added a name to it. We have added a form to it. That's all. And you break it, make another pot, another size pot, another name and form you give. Clay continues in all these various manifestations. Vacharambhanam Vikaro Namadheyam Mrityagetyeva Satyam. The teacher telling the student, Chandogya Upanishad, all these various pots and pans and plates, what are they? So many vikaras, modifications with a name, that's all. Essentially, it is all clay, it is all clay. That's the truth mentioned there. Tasmat etat brahma matram hi vishwam. Na adhishthanat bhinnata aropitasya. What is superimposed cannot have any existence apart from the base itself, the substratum itself. The substratum, you can superimpose anything on it, but it remains the same. Brahman is the substratum of the universe. Then, says here, verse 236, Bhrantyasya yadyat Brahmata pratidam Brahmaivatattat rajatam hi shuktihi idantaya brahma sadaiva rupyate dvaropitam brahmani nama matram. He says, whenever a deluded man, Bhrantyasya yadyat Brahmata pratidam, through his delusion, he sees so many things. We say, this is this, that is that, all the differences, only because we are subject to this delusion, this maya, by which we are not able to see clearly truth itself. But when you investigate, Brahmaiva Tattat, it is all Brahman only, just like Rajatam Hi Shukti Hi. When you see a mother of pearl, say there, actually it is mistaken for silver. It is appeared to be a mother of pearl. Silver is nothing but the mother of pearl. You thought it is silver. It is just a mother of pearl. Idantaya Brahma Sadaiva Rupyate. Brahman is constantly becoming manifested as the Idam, 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 this universe. What a wonderful idea. The whole universe is constantly the manifestation of Brahman in various forms. Idantaya Brahma Sadaiva Rupyate. When you deal with astronomy, you deal with that Big Bang theory. That Big Bang which started the expansion of this universe, evolution of this universe. It was highly concentrated energy before it. It expanded, exploded, and the world came into being. First explosion. When you wind up this universe, there will be another event called implosion. A thing what inwardly it goes back into its own condensed form. So this is the Sankocha Vikasa of Vedantic thought. Expansion, contraction, expansion, contraction. Constantly going on. Brahman is just expanding with the universe. Contracting, universe is taken away. Now, this concept is put into art in our religion. There you get the picture of Vishnu, that Anandashayana. The whole world is sucked up into himself. He is alone there, a pure being existing there. That is the concept of this wonderful concept of Vishnu, the one who lives in the Kshirasagara, the wonderful imagination, the entire cosmos reduced to Kshirasagara, in which Vishnu remains at the eternal self when he is in a half sleepy condition. When he opens the eyes, the universe comes into being. When he closes the eyes, universe is wound up. That is the high concept in these beautiful art pieces in our tradition. That famous French scholar Zimmer has written his book, The Myths and Symbols of the Hindu Religion. What profound truths are sought to be conveyed through these myths and symbols? For us, we are all thinking of myth and symbol. What is it a symbol of? So, such books help us to understand these things better. Profoundest truths need symbols to express them. Just like geometry. How much of mathematics is expressed through symbols? A, B, C, X, Y, Z. Symbols are needed. But you must know what the symbols mean. You carry away the X, Y, Z. I first went to a bank when I was a new brahmachari. I didn't know the meaning of symbol. I knew things, but not symbols. So I gave a check for cashing, 25 rupees. They gave me a small symbol, a sort of a token in my hand. Then he went away into the bank. I was thinking, this man is cheating me. I have given 25 rupees check. He has given me a token. What shall I do with it? Then a man told me, boy, don't worry. It's only a token. He has to do some work there. Then he will come and give you the money. I was running away with the token. How foolish I was. In life, that is what happens. We run away with the token. We don't know what truth is. So he says, Prantasya yad yad pramata pratidam brahmaiva tattad rajatam hi shuktihi. It's only, the silver is only that mother of pearl. Idantaya brahma sadaiva rupyate aropitam brahmani nama matram. We have only added some name and form to what is Brahman all the time. The whole universe is Brahman in this manifested form. And this manifestation is going on all time. Brahman is manifesting as the universe. Therefore, jnatru jnaya jnana shunyam anantam nirvikalpakam 239 kevala akhanda chin matram param tattvam vidur buddhaha. Wise people know this truth, that supreme truth, param tattvam buddhaha viduhu. Supreme truth is known by the wise sages. What is the nature of the supreme truth? Kevala akhanda chin matram, that non-dual, undivided, pure consciousness. That is the supreme truth. That is what the sages know. What is its special characteristic? Jnatra jnanat jnaya shunyam, free from the distinctions of knower, knowledge, and object of knowledge. These triputi, we call it in Vedantic language, triputi, distinction between subject, object, and knowledge. This is called triputi. You resolve the triputi into a supreme unity. That's called the field experience, consciousness field, of which one pole is object, one pole is subject and over, and the Atman is all the three. You resolve all the three into that supreme truth. Jnatra jnaya jnana shunyam, anantam, infinite. Nirvikalpakam, without any modification, is the Atman. That is the true nature. Kevala akhanda chin matram, of the nature of chit, pure consciousness, one and undivided, param tattvam, that is the supreme truth. Buddha, wise people, know this. By knowing this, one becomes wise. That's also the same meaning. When you come to this realization, aheyam, anupadeyam, manovacham, agocharam, aprameyam, anadyantam, brahma, purnamaham, mahaha. This is the realization you have. I am the Brahman. Fullness, Purnam. There is nothing fraction there. Purnam, Maha, the infinite. That Brahman I am. In this, Aprameyam, nothing can measure it. Immeasurable. Prameya is measuring. Logic is thought measuring things through logic. So Prameya we call it. This is Aprameya. No thought, no logic. None of these can measure it, beyond all measurement, aprameyam, anadyantam, no adi, no antam, no beginning, no end. That is the nature of infinite. Aheyam, anupadeyam, there is nothing to reject, there is nothing to accept in this infinite Atman. Aheyam, anupadeyam, manovacham, agocharam, mind and speech cannot comprehend it. How can the poor speech comprehend the Atman? How can this mind comprehend the Atman? It is the Atman's energy that makes the mind and the sense organs function. So how can these comprehend the Atman? This is repeatedly stressed Vedanta. Manovacham agocharam. Whatever is beyond speech, beyond mind. Mind means conceptualization. The Atman cannot be made a concept because it becomes an object. The Atman is never an object. So conceptualization, intellectualization has no reference to the Atman. One beautiful slogan in the Ashtavakra Gita says, whatever I see only myself. The object is only myself. I am the subject, I am the object. In the dream, you see a tiger. And you are an entity, tiger is an entity. And your actions are there, running about, fear, everything is there. But what is all this? Only mind. Nothing but the mind. But you find differences there. And they are real in the dream. But the truth is, it is all mind, nothing but the mind. Similarly, regarding the whole universe of experience, this Brahman is one and non-dual. You are that. Brahma Purna Maham. I am that Purna Brahman. That infinite Brahman. Mahaha. The great. The infinite. That is my nature. Then, says 245. Athata adesha iti shruti swayam. Nishedhati brahmane kalpitam dvayam. Shruti pramana anugrihita bodhat. Tayo nirasa karaniya eva. This shruti, the Upanishads, they are highly respected in India. In fact, whenever you say, Shruti says so, we respect it. Because it's a report of real experience. Not only so, an experience which you can repeat for yourself. Verified and verifiable, as we say in scientific language. Not merely verified. Verified and somebody believes. No. Verified, verifiable. So it is called Shruti. Contains such fund of spiritual experiences. It has got such a prestige in India. In every book you will find respectful reference to Shruti. And the other is Smriti. Day-to-day laws and regulations about food, marriage, inheritance, they don't have that status. They come and go. Smritis come and go. Even now we have got completely new Smritis. None of the old Smritis are relevant today. But Shruti, all time, for all people, because they deal with truths, profound truths, regarding you, regarding me, regarding our ultimate destiny. This doesn't change for Indians, Americans, Russians, or anybody. That is the status of the Shruti, highly respected. It is called apaurusheya, impersonal, and therefore universal. Personal cannot be universal. A religion given by a person cannot be universal. Religion based on principles, truths, discovered by people, can be rediscovered by you. That alone can be universal. That is the character of Sanatana Dharma among the religions of the world. This Dharma has no individual founder. It is founded on principles, truths, discovered by sages, to be rediscovered by you and me. That's how the sages developed a remarkable philosophy and religion, absolutely impersonal, universal, and yet the womb of mighty personalities, great incarnations, gigantic personalities come out of the womb of that impersonality, the impersonal, personal combination. Impersonal makes for universality. Personal makes for deep individual satisfaction. You are related to a person, you feel happy, very good. There is no harm. Never forget the impersonal background. Otherwise you become narrow, dogmatic, intolerant. That the Hindu tradition has been comparatively free from intolerance, violence and persecution, even of atheists and agnostics, is entirely due to this tremendous impersonal background of this great spiritual tradition coming from 5,000 years, fresh even today. That is Sanatana Dharma. So he says here, this, Athata Adesha Iti Shruti Swayam. Shruti itself says, in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Athata Adeshaha, that is how the text begins. He is referring to that. Athata Adesha Iti Shruti Swayam. Shruti herself says this, Nishedhati Brahmane Kalpitam Dvayam. Whatever duality has been imagined in Brahman, Shruti negates it. No. Asthulam, Anano, Akhraswam. This is the passage. It is not gross. It is not subtle. It is not fine. It is not this. It is not that. All that is negated in the Atman. Shruti itself says it. Shruti pramana anugrihita bodhat. Let your mind be immersed in the great truths of the Shruti. Then you will get the strength to penetrate into the heart of truth yourself. Tayo nirasa karaniya eva. All these dualities and multiplicities to be rejected and negated. Realizing the supreme oneness. Here is a white man, here is a black man. Today we are taught. Remember, the Homo sapien is one entity. Don't be carried away by the differences. Develop a mankind awareness. Even in limited field of human life, you find this tendency. You must realize that unity behind the diversity. Then diversity will not delude you, will not lead to conflict and violence, etc. So, try to strengthen your mind in this thought. Everything is that supreme Brahman. Asthuram. Upanishad says the next verse, 250. It is not gross, asthulam, ananu, it is not subtle, it's not an atom, that kind of thing. Itya nirasya siddham svato vyomavat apradarkyam. Then you come to Brahman exactly like the sky. Sky cut up into a pot, into a pan, into a cloth, into a house. All these are cut up here and there. But you understand, what is the sky? The space, unlimited, infinite, undivided. Similarly here, these divisions are overcome in that supreme oneness. Ato mrishamatram idam pratitam. All these differences which you see, certainly you see. But is it true? That is what makes for science. Seeing is not science. What you see, you investigate. That's meaning of datum. Sense datum. It's only a datum. Then you question it. You see the earth is flat. That is what our senses repeat all the time. Then you investigate. Oh, you can't believe the senses. The earth is round. Nearby it looks flat only. Similarly, hundreds of experiences, they are all true from the sensory point of view. But we question them, then something else happens, truth comes out. Similarly, this diversity, when you question, it cannot stand. Everything is Brahman, everything is pure consciousness. Yahihi yat swatmataya grihitam. Overcome this sense of separateness, sense of difference between man and man. We all thought, all the rest of the people in the world, other than the Hindus, are all mlechas. We won't trade with them. That's what we did. Even after shaking hands with the viceroy, our Maharajas used to go and take a bath also. Such was the condition of our mind. Narrow, sectarian, based on differences. Now we realize the truth. We are all one. No distinction between man and man. That is real knowledge. Carry it still further. You come to this realization. Brahmahamityevi vishuddhaya. That pure knowledge, I am Brahman. Vidhisvam atmanam akhandabodham. Realize your own nature as that non-dual, undivided Brahman. The word division. What is it that divides a thing? Say, for example, ocean. You call it Indian Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean. Ocean doesn't need any of these differences. You are making a division for your convenience only. Use it as a convenience, but don't dogmatize that this is separate from that. Ocean is one surrounding the earth. This is how the mind deludes us. And when we discriminate, delusion goes away. Now comes two big verses, very majestic, full of deep meaning. Mrutkaryam sagalam, 251 and 52. Mrutkaryam sagalam, ghatati satatam, mrinmatramevahitam, tadvat sajjanitam, sadatmagamidam, sanmatramevakhilam. Yasmannasti sataparam kimapi, tat satyam sa atma swayam, tasmat tattvamasi prashantam amalam. Brahmadvayam yatparam. He says, mrutkaryam sakalam ghatati satatam mrinmatramevahitam. Whatever is made of clay, every one of them is essentially clay only. Mrinmatram. Similarly, tadvat sajjanitam, whatever comes from sat, the supreme truth, the whole universe, sadatmakamitam, it is sadatmakam, it is pure truth itself, Brahman itself, sanmatramevakhilam, everything is sanmatram, satmatram, that is the nature of the universe. Yasmannasti sataparam, there is nothing beyond sat, it is the supreme, there is nothing beyond it. Kimapi, nothing. Tat satyam, that is the truth. Sa atma, that is your own self, swayam, that is yourself. This is a wonderful truth conveyed to us. Therefore, tasmat tattvamasi, you are that. You think you are a creature. You think you are the body. You think you are this petty thing or petty individual. No, you are not. You are that infinite reality. Tattvamasi. Prashantam, absolutely calm and tranquil. Amalam, absolutely pure. Brahmadvayam, that non-dual Brahman. Tat yat param, which is supreme. That is your true nature. This is the theme in the Chandogya Upanishad. The father telling the son, every time this is repeated, say, Aida Dhatme Midam Sarvam. This is the self of all in the universe. Tat Satyam, that is the truth. Sa Atma, that's the Atman. And then finally, Tattvamasi Shvetaketo. Shvetaketo, you are that. Father telling the son, you are that. You are not this tiny little thing. You are that infinite thing. When you see a baby, newly born, 7 pounds in weight, so slender, so tender, a little extra heat and cold can destroy it. But within that baby is a profound dimension. That's philosophy and science that discloses this profound dimension of a newborn baby is Vedanta. After a few years, he becomes a scholar, Olympic champion, a Muhammad Ali in this kind of boxing, or a tremendous saint and teacher. All that is hidden in the child. That is how Brahman unfolds in the child. All education, all spiritual development is the unfolding of something infinite coiled up in that little newborn organism. That's a Vedantic teaching. Tasmat tattvamasi prashantam amalam. You may feel weak now. You may feel helpless now. But that is only your feeling. Truth is otherwise. That infinite truth is there in you. Infinite energy is there in you. Vedanta repeatedly will mention this truth. Tattvamasi. This is appealing to many great scientific thinkers. So far as man is concerned, the profound truth. As Louis D. Broglie, famous nuclear scientist, wrote an article in a London journal on the poetry of pure science. What a wonderful. He quoted a passage from Pascal, mathematician mystic, 18th century. Pascal says, in space, the universe engulfs me and reduces me to a pinpoint. But through thought, I understand that universe. Physically speaking, we are a speck of dust. But in that speck of dust is a tremendous dimension. It can understand this world. It can understand reality. What a wonderful dimension. That's meaning of this tattvamasi. You are that. Prashantam amalam. Brahmadvayam. Yatparam. And the next verse says, Nidra kalpita deshakala visayajnatrati sarvam yatha mithya tadvadihapi yagrati jagatsvatjnana karyatvataha yasmadevamidam sharirakarana prana aham asat tasmat tattvamasi prashantam amalam. Brahmadvayam yatparam. He says, Nidra kalpita deshakala visayajnatrati sarvam yatha mithya. When you go to sleep, you begin to dream. And you throw up so many things in the dream. So many events. So many experiences. And what are they? Every one of them, a tissue of delusion. Mithya. Every one of them. The tiger in the dream. You are shivering in your dream. Your fear, you are running away, enjoying a good meal. Everything is mithya. Nidra kalpita. Desha kala. Time, space, notions in dream. They are all unreal. Sometimes you have lived so many years in a dream. Actually, 2 seconds, 5 seconds of the time only you found there. Similarly, tadva dihapi. Similarly, in this life itself, jagrati, in this waking state, jagat swatnyana kadya tvataha. The whole with jagat is a projection of our delusion, of our ignorance. You are not able to see Brahman in everything, though it is the truth. We have projected so many things on that basis, substratum of Brahman. Yasma devam idam, therefore it is sharirakarana pranaham adyapyaham asat. All this body, mind, sensory system, bioenergy, innas, pranas, these are all asat. What is truth is Brahman alone. That is the truth about it. Tasmat tattvamasi. therefore you are that, you are that. Prashantam amalam brahmadvayam yat param, that supreme Brahman, that is your true nature. When we wake up from dream, we realize, what was the dream? Only mind. Mind in various forms. Even the time sense, even the space sense in dream is nothing but the mind. This truth shines when you wake up from the dream. So this dream of ignorance, when we wake up from it, what do you see? Everything is Brahman. That is the shloka. Gaudapada writes in the Mandukya Karika, Anadi Maya Supto Yada Jiva Prabhudhyate Ajanma Nidram Aswapnam Advaitam Budhyate Tada. When this Jiva, this limited soul, wakes up from his sleep of ages, what does he realize? He has been sleeping for ages in this Maya. Anadi Maya Supto Yada Jiva Prabhudhyate. He is now waking up from that Maya sleep. What does he see? Ajanma Nidrama Swapnam Advaitam. He realizes that infinite Brahman, one and non-dual, which is Ajanmam. It has no birth or death. Anidram. It has no sleep. Aswapnam. It has no dream. Advaitam Buddhyate Tada. That is the eternal waking state. We call it in Sanskrit, Chira Jagrat. Constant Jagrat. In this Jagrat, there is coming and going. Sometimes we wink in the Jagrat state. We lose our consciousness. We go to dream, we go to sleep. That's a normal Jagrat. But there is Jagrat eternal. When I go to Holland, Holland is covered by fog all the time, like England, both the countries. Rarely we get a little sunlight, even in this April, May, and March and all that. So when I go there, I stand high up in the sky, 30,000 feet above the clouds. Everything is sunlight. But down below, it is all darkness. It is all fog. When I come down and land, all foggy. So I used to make fun. You make a nice balloon, about 20,000 feet rope, right there. Put a chair in it. Do your work there in that height. Come down when you want to sleep only. That's where you can be always in sunlight. Otherwise, this up and down. When I climbed Alps near Munich, same thing, full of fog. You can't see anything here. We went up 12,000 feet. Everything is bright sunshine. Our normal experience is the same. In this deluded state, we fight, we quarrel, we hate each other, we kill each other. All these petty notions come. Why? We are all in ignorance, darkness, delusion. But behind it is that infinite Atman. What a tragedy. In spite of having this as our true nature, we forget it. Shankara goes into ecstasy when he treats of this subject in the Kathopanishad. Aho, adigambhira, vichitra, cha iyam maya. This maya is adigambhira, tremendous, terrific, variegated. Man is essentially the Atman. He doesn't realize it. Even though he is taught, and without being taught, he treats himself as a body, and to fatten the body, goes on killing people, exploiting people, doing petty things. What a tragedy. Aho, adigambhira, vichitra cha iyam maya. He goes on saying there. So he says here, this, yatra bhrantya kalpitam tat viveke, tatan matram naiva tasmat vivinnam. Whenever a thing is imagined to be something else, it is only during that imaginative period it is true. When that imagination delusion goes away, that real thing shines before you. Tasmat swapne nashtam swapna vishyam vichitram. Whatever universe you saw in the dream is destroyed with the dream. You don't carry it over the waking. If somebody does so, he will have a very unhappy waking state also. Carrying the dream, it is a waking. Tasmat bhinnam kinnu dushtam prabodhe. When you wake up from that dream, what you find except yourself? The whole universe you saw disappears when you wake up from the dream and you are left alone. That is a wonderful example Vedanta often uses. Having said this, that wonderful idea expressed in the last line, Tasmat tattvamasit prashantam amalam. You are that supreme truth, the Atman. Even a little knowledge of this can save us from fear, pettiness, meanness. If you know it better, fully, tremendous character strength will come to the people. Now comes a wonderful section, verse 254 onwards, 10 shlokas, which are highly musical, highly deeply spiritual, where now the teacher says to the student, I have given you enough instruction. Now learn to understand this truth, meditate, realize it for yourself.
Tasmat tattvamasi prashantam amalam brahmadvayam yatparam. Therefore, you are that infinite reality, tattvamasi, that Brahman, free from all imperfection, impurity, non-dual, supreme. That is your true nature. In all the two verses, this became the refrain, tasmat tattvamasi prashantam amalam brahmadvayam yat param, that supreme. Now comes a series of 10 verses where the teacher is telling the student, now I have given you the exposition of this philosophy, a penetrating study of man and the discovery of the immortal behind the mortal, the infinite behind the finite. That is the supreme message of Sanatana Dharma, of Vedanta, to all humanity. It is a truth which can be realized by everyone, because that is one's birthright. We have not to beg and borrow this truth from anybody. Only we have to be aware of it. This therefore formula, tat svam asi, that thou art, not this, but that. This means this limited, truncated entity. That means the infinite one. Now this beautiful truth, in these three words, tat svam asi, is inspiring many scientific thinkers today who have studied physical nature. And when they turn to man, they find this truth most relevant. I refer to two of them. One nuclear physicist, Schrodinger. He specifically mentioned this very statement of tattvamasi, and what a profound truth it is for man to understand himself, establish happy relations with others. The second scientist is a microbiologist, Professor J.D.S. Haldane, Englishman. He left England, established his laboratory in Bhubaneswar, where he passed away. Very outstanding molecular biologist. In one lecture on unity in diversity, he referred to this. Recently, I have been to Germany to visit my biologist friend. As I entered his laboratory, I found a writing above the doorway, and I was impressed, because that was tattvamasi, that thou art. A German microbiologist keeping that motto in front of his laboratory. They are working in the field of molecular biology. But the truth, they cannot escape. The truth about man, tattvamasi, tattvamasi. He referred to this in his lecture, then told the audience, even if one of you can realize the meaning of that utterance, my lecture is satisfied, fulfilled. That was J.B.S. Haldane's way of putting it. Schrodinger also puts it similarly. It is a profound truth about man, not visible to the senses. Sensorily, if you examine, you will never find it. You will see a truncated entity, this creature that is called man. A little hunger and thirst can destroy him. But there is some profound dimension within him. Before the body breaks away, realize that truth. That is how the sages of India exhort every human being. This body is a beautiful instrument to study the world of nature. to enjoy the delights of existence and forge ahead in the search for truth regarding yourself and realize it in this very body. That is where the stress is placed in all of our literature. One particular verse in Sanskrit certainly brings this urgency before you and me. This body we have got for a few years with us. What shall we do with it? Of course, we shall use it to handle this world, to understand it, enjoy the delight, but never forget there is something else to it. Before it breaks away, realize this truth. Tattvamasi, Tattvamasi. That sloga says in Sanskrit, Mahata Punyabanyena Kritoyam Kayanau Tvaya Taram Dukhodathir Gantam Tara Yavatna Bhidyate Mahata Punyabanyena. By paying Mahata Punyapanyena, by paying a heavy price. Pana means money. Punya means good works you have done. Accumulated lots of such good works. With that money, Kritoyam Kayanau Svaya. This ship of your body, physical body, you have purchased yourself. Body is compared to a nau, means a ship. You have purchased it. What is it for? Is it for decoration here? No. Param Dukhodathir Gantum. To cross this ocean of sorrow, delusion, deprivation, alienation. That is the sorrow in which you are all moving. Just to cross it. Then what shall we do? Shall we take it easy? No. How long will the ship remain? It may get cracked. It may get broken. Tara yavatna bhityate. Before it breaks up, cross this ocean. Utilize this body for that purpose. You have paid a heavy price for it. That is the sense of urgency that our teachers give us on this subject. Don't take it easy. Young, vital, vigorous, let some thought to be given to this great subject. Then we shall have high character. Even though we are busy finding our place in this world, earning money, rearing family, getting some good name from society, all that is beautiful. But side by side, never forget this deeper search, so that later on you can concentrate more on it when you are able to withdraw more and more from this work and earning and spending in the world. So that is the language our Shastras use. Tara yavatna bhityate. Cross before the boat breaks down, breaks up. So this is the emphasis, the importance of this teaching. Tat tvam asi. Infinite energy is hidden within this human system. At what level? Not at the physical level. Very ordinary energy. This muscle, how much energy is there? A little inward, the nervous system, more energy is there and more subtle. Still inward, psyche, more energy is there. Still limited. High intellect, very limited energy. A little trouble in life, intellectuals can commit suicide. They can't stand the stress and strain. Intellectual energy is not so high. Behind the intellect is the Atman. That is infinite energy. That is how the Upanishad and Shankaracharya give us the spectrum of energy resources hidden in every human being. As you go inward, you find more immense, more subtle forms of energy. Muscle is a very gross energy. We call it bull power in India, horse power in the West. It is very ordinary. Today we can construct rockets with million horsepower thrust. What is this horsepower we use? What is the tiny muscle? This is nothing. The brain of man can invent these rockets with a million horsepower thrust. That is the power of the brain. But that very brain can become upset. With a little untoward experience in life, all that brain becomes upset. We become depressed. We commit suicide. Forgetting that behind the brain, there is a tremendous reservoir of energy. That is the teaching emphasized again and again. That's the true meaning of religion. Religion is not some doing this and doing that. To understand this truth, we are children of God, children of immortality,
Amrutasya Putraha. As the Upanishads would say, this truth must slowly dawn on us. Then ethics, morality, good life, service, dedication, all this will flow spontaneously, naturally. Nobody need thrust people into the moral life. There is no need for do's and don'ts. You grow spiritually, you develop this awareness, everything that you do will be for the good of all. You are realizing yourself as one with all. In some slogans later, this idea comes. Sarvatma bhava. I am the self of all. How can I injure anyone? I am one with all. Break down this barrier. Sense of separateness. There's a teaching in Vedanta. And so, this wonderful exhortation in refrain given in 2 verses becomes the theme of 10 verses hereafter, where the teacher tells the student, now take your mind to this level of subtlety, understanding, so that you will realize this truth. It's not a matter of belief. Belief that milk will nourish me will not nourish you. You have to drink the milk. Mere belief has no meaning at all. The Hindu religion never stresses on belief. Extremely secondary is belief. What is needed is an effort to realize the truth. That is stressed always. Anubhava, anubhava. A man can write a big volume on love and get a thesis and a PhD degree for it. If you ask him, do you know how to love? That I don't know. I can write a volume on love. I don't know how to love. Similarly, in theory of religion, you know so many things. You have not experienced a single bit of it. Experience something of it. Vivekananda used to say humorously, if a materialist can experience even a ghost one day, even then there should be tremendous growth. Even a ghost, you see, not merely this current material reality, something subtle you have seen. He used to say like that, we don't need a ghost here. We are dealing with our own true nature. Beyond this gross level, the subtlest reality is there. All energy is focused there. So the Guru tells the disciple, you are that. Now realize it. Realize it. Go beyond this world of name and form. Beyond this gross universe which we experience with our senses. Those 10 verses are marvelous. Both as philosophy, mysticism, and poetry. Here we begin. Verse 254, and then 10 verses continuously. He is telling the disciple, you must keep in view, the Guru is sitting there, disciple is sitting there. Now comes the plunging. We stand on the edge of the swimming pool and go on talking about swimming. Finally, the whistle. Now plunge. Then you will find real fun. You plunge into the swimming pool. What a wonderful thing. This is called plunging. Dive deep, dive deep, dive deep. Sri Ramakrishna used to sing a song. Doop, 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 Rupa Sagare. Oh mind, dive deep, dive deep, dive deep into that ocean of beauty. Great gems are there. That is the language the teacher uses here in these 10 verses. Here are the verses. Jati niti kula gotra duragam. Namarupa guna dosha varjitam. Desha kala vishayati vartiyat. Brahma tattvamasi bhava yatmani. That Brahman, tattvamasi, you are that, you are that. Bhava yatmani. Meditate on this truth in yourself. Realize it in yourself. What kind of Brahman? The rest is explanation of the nature of that Brahman. Jati niti kula gotra duragam. Beyond all the limitations of jati, niti, kula, gotra. What a beautiful idea. Caste or class. Jati means caste or class. Here it is caste. In other countries it is class. Caste and class do not affect this Atman. It's beyond all this limitation. Niti, do's and don'ts in life. So many rules and regulations are there. This Atman is beyond all this. Kula, genetic family. Gotra, again, a wider type of God, family, relationship. This is beyond all this limitation. Jati, niti, kula, gotra, duragam. Similarly, nama, rupa, guna, dosha, varjitam. Free from name, form,